Visualizing the derivative of a surface parametrization. Suppose we have a differentiable function from a region in R2 to R3. We've seen that its partial derivatives fit conveniently in a 3x2 matrix. But what does this matrix represent? To explore this question, let's look at an example. Here's a parametrization of a torus sitting in space. This is a function, f, from a square to R3. You feed it two numbers, s and t, both at least 0 and at most 2 pi, and it spits out a point on the torus. The x-coordinate of this point is given by 2 plus cosine s times cosine t. The y-coordinate is given by 2 plus cosine s times sine t, and the z-coordinate is given by sine s. This might look like a jumble of symbols, but let's think a bit about what this parametrization is doing to the square. First, let's look at what it's doing to the horizontal line s equals 0. If we set s equal to 0, then the function becomes 3 times the cosine of t, 3 times the sine of t, 0. As t varies from 0 to 2 pi, this traces out a circle of radius 3 in the xy plane. This is the big circle curving around the torus as far from the hole as possible. What if we look at a different horizontal line instead? Like s equals pi over 2, for example. When we set s equal to pi over 2, the function becomes 2 times the cosine of t, 2 times the sine of t, 1. Now, as t varies, this traces out a circle of radius 2 in the plane z equals 1, hovering 1 unit above the xy plane. In fact, this parametrization turns all horizontal lines into horizontal circles, parallel to the xy plane, running around the hole in the torus. Now let's look at a vertical line instead. If we set t equal to 0, the function becomes 2 plus cosine s, 0, sine s. This is a circle in the xz plane, with radius 1, centered at the point 2, 0, 0. This circle curves through the hole in the torus. In fact, our parametrization turns all vertical lines into vertical circles, running through the torus's hole. If you had a square made out of really squishy rubber, you could think of this function as a set of instructions for stretching and squashing the square, gluing its edges together to make a torus, and then placing this torus in space. Now let's look at the derivative of this function. First, we treat s as constant and t as a variable to find the derivative with respect to t. We get that dx dt is negative the quantity 2 plus cosine s times sine t. dy dt is the quantity 2 plus cosine s times cosine t. And dz dt is 0. Next, we take the partial derivatives with respect to s. dx ds is negative sine s cosine t, dy ds is negative sine s sine t, and dz ds is the cosine of s. Now we have a 3x2 matrix, full of partial derivatives, and we can ask again, what does this all mean? Well, we know that matrices represent linear transformations. If we pick values for s and t and plug them in, we'll get a matrix full of real numbers, representing a linear transformation that turns vectors in the plane into vectors in space. For example, if we set both s and t equal to 0, this matrix becomes 0, 3, 0, 0, 0, 1. So what does this particular linear transformation do? If we feed it the vector 1, 0, pointing to the right on the t-axis, we'll get the vector 0, 3, 0 in space. And if we feed it the vector 0, 1, pointing upwards on the s-axis, we'll get the vector 0, 0, 1. We could picture both of these vectors based at the origin in R3, like we usually do. But we could also imagine them based somewhere else, like at the point f of 0, 0, for example. This is the point 3, 0, 0 in space. It's where the parametrization sends the lower left corner of our square. Notice that these vectors both fit neatly on our torus now, both of them tangent to it. We can do this for any point in the square. If we pick a point on the square, call it A, B, we get one parametrized path in space by setting s equal to b. This path traces out the horizontal circle that passes through the point f of a, b. When we differentiate f with respect to t, and then plug in a and b for t and s, we get the velocity vector of this path, right as it passes through the point in question. If we instead let s vary, and set t equal to a, we get a different parametrized path, this time tracing out the vertical circle that passes through f of a, b. When we differentiate f with respect to s, and then plug in a and b, we get the velocity vector for this second path as it passes through our point. So when we take our derivative matrix and plug in a and b, we get a linear transformation. We can think of this linear transformation as taking vectors in the plane based at the point a, b, and turning them into tangent vectors on the torus based at the point f of a, b. Here's one way to think about it. Suppose you have a particle moving around in your square along a differentiable path. We can imagine another particle moving around on the torus, simultaneously following an analogous path. So when one particle is at p, the other particle is at f of p. At any given moment, these particles both have velocity vectors, one in the plane and the other in space, tangent to the torus. What's the relationship between these two vectors? The matrix of derivatives at the relevant point gives us exactly that relationship. If you feed this matrix the velocity vector in the plane, you always get the velocity vector in space. The matrix tells you what this parametrization does to vectors based at points in the domain. It might stretch them, or squash them, or point them in one direction or another as it places them on the torus. But in general, if you want to know what a parametrization is doing to a certain vector, just ask the matrix of derivatives.